Hello friends, welcome to One Academy. Let's crack NEET PG together. And I'm Dr. Shonali Chandra, and in this particular video I shall be speaking about how to effectively read and revise. Now friends, in my previous video I talked about the effective ways of learning, the importance of strategizing and making a schedule. And now that we have our schedule ready and we do sit down to read, a lot of questions come to our mind, like from where should I be reading and which topic should I be reading first and which topic should I be reading at a later point in time, how frequently should I be revising and reading. So let's get started. Now we are in this habit of reading from multiple sources, and it's absolutely okay. And we have notes that we have created on our own, notes that we've made, or we have notes that we've borrowed from friends. We have chits lying around and flashcards that we have made, maybe textbooks that we are referring to. Now the standard textbook for obstetrics is Williams Obstetrics, and the standard textbook for gynecology is Novak's Gynecology. Now these are heavy duty textbooks. They you can't be expected to read them right in your preparation year. So, but you can always refer to them in case of doubts and queries and controversies, right? And then finally, the internet is a vast source of information as well. We are seeing online content and videos all the time. So yes, we have multiple sources, but make it a point that the first time that you do go through a content, you compile it into a single source, no matter where you are reading from or what you are seeing. This is extremely, extremely important. Now see, if you walk into a room and the room is filled with books and there are books lying on the bed and the table is filled with papers lying around, you do get that feeling that okay, a lot of study is going on in this room. But trust me, when you will sit down and try to revise, that is when the problem will arise, because you tend to forget from which book you had read a particular chapter, from which notes had you read this particular thing, or which video did you see, right? So until unless everything is compiled into a single source, revision becomes a nuisance and becomes a task, because you can't be repeating the process of reading the first time. All right, so you can't be rereading. So revision needs to be smart, and to be able to do that revision, your first reading, for the first reading, should be thorough, right? So please remember that you are thorough with your first reading, you are making down notes, you are compiling everything into a single source, and you're reading the important topics from A to Z. Right? Because that is how you will build concepts, my friends, when you are going to go from the bottom up approach, right? So if you feel that, if you think that when you read for the first time and you can do away with just reading the headings, no, that's not the way to go about it. So be thorough in the first reading. Avoid doing this. Avoid over highlighting. You see, some of us have this tendency of, we think that the more we are highlighting, and whatever we are highlighting is directly going into the brain. Well, that's not true, you see, because if you were to open this textbook again and try to figure out what are the important points, you can't find them there, in a book that has been marked or highlighted like this. So keep highlight to a minimum. Only highlight the most important areas. Like for example, you can place a tick at a paragraph from which a question has been asked, or you can mark a cue over there, or you can highlight the keywords. Or let's say the first time you were reading, there was a concept, it was difficult to grasp and it took you much longer, and you feel that, this, I might forget this and I need to come back and see it again. So that particular point you can highlight. So keep highlight to minimum, avoid over highlighting. And most importantly, break the content into chunks. We have big subjects to read, and those subjects also contain big topics. It is wiser to divide each topic into smaller chunks. Like for example, if I decide to read fibroid and adenomyosis today, these are the two topics that I decide to read. And yes, I decide to read them one after the other because they present clinically in a similar manner. Both of them present with heavy menstrual bleeding. And it is a wise idea to read the differential diagnoses first, all right? So very, very important, you've broken the chapter abnormal uterine bleeding into smaller chapters, right? The smaller chapters are fibroid, adenomyosis, maybe endometrial polyps and malignancies and hormonal disturbance. So the various causes of abnormal bleeding, right? And each cause of abnormal bleeding has to be subdivided into smaller chunks. So let's say, for example, you start reading what is a fibroid, right? So you start reading with the pathology first, then that's your first chunk. Then the second chunk is what are the clinical features, right? So that's your second chunk. Then the diagnosis is your third chunk, and the fourth chunk can be the treatment. Similarly, now when you'll read adenomyosis the next time, you start reading what is adenomyosis. So you compare how is it different from a fibroid. When you read the clinical features of adenomyosis, you realize, okay, it also presents with heavy menstrual bleeding, but there's something different. How is the bleeding of adenomyosis different from that seen in a fibroid uterus, right? What are the differences in physical findings, right? How do we come to a diagnosis? Okay, I did ultrasound for fibroid. But when I'm reading the text in adenomyosis, I'm seeing that I have to do something else. Ultrasound is not that good. Maybe I need an MRI. Why is that, right? So always, always compare the differential diagnosis, and it is easier to compare the separate chunks. It is easier to compare the pathology independently than the clinical features and the physical findings independently. And that is a way of training your brain, you see, because the smaller pockets of information are retained better for a longer period of time. So yes, you have to get in the habit of learning like this, and this is how you will develop this focused learning of concepts, and these are the techniques that will help you build your concepts, right? So please keep that in mind. Break the content into chunks. Now friends, practice makes perfect. We have all heard about that, right? We've all heard this saying. Now, let's say, what do you need to practice now? You need to practice this particular habit of making chunks of information into your brain. Because see, this is how the brain works. You know, you have one chunk for fibroid, one chunk for adenomyosis information, the other chunk for some other topic. And then when I ask you, or when you start reading abnormal uterine bleeding, now you can extract information from each of these separate chunks, compare them, and come to a diagnosis. You will have to keep repeating this process. That is what the practice is. Remember, when you go into the wards or in the OPDs as a medical graduate student, and you are grappling with the patient's history and the examination, and you are scratching your head because you want to come to a diagnosis fast, you're doing a case prep, and a senior resident walks in or a professor walks in and he talks to the patient for 10 minutes and he just asks the relevant points in history, just looks at the relevant point on examination, and snap, that's his diagnosis, that's his plan. Now, you say that is experience, that is his experience. I agree. It's actually practice, and the practice of breaking down content into chunks that they have mastered by repeating the process over and over again. And while they are doing it at their clinics, you have to do it while preparing in your, or you know, on your desk. So you have to get into this habit of reading small information first and then combining it to study the topic as a whole, right? So eventually revision is going to make it permanent, right? So if you ask me which topics to read first and which to read later, I would tell you read the individual fibroid, adenomyosis, or other hormonal disturbances, endometrial polyps. Read these topics first, all right? And then start taking questions on abnormal uterine bleeding as a whole or as an entire clinical approach. So that is what is important. If you start reading abnormal uterine bleeding first and then going back to reading fibroid, it's like jumping into a swimming pool when you don't know how to swim, right? So don't do that. Now, moving on, how to revise, right? What and how frequently to revise. So revision should basically be a recall-based approach, right? That means that when you're trying to revise a topic, please think about that topic mentally with your books closed. Right, revise or recall what you remember about the topic, and you can again go through your chunks. You said you made a chunk about the pathology, so remember what important points are there. Then try to remember the clinical features, then try to remember the diagnosis. So each time, you know, recall the smaller chunks that you had created in your brain, and you can do this at the end of each topic. You should do this at the end of each topic. You should read what you read yesterday as well. You should, you know, recall what you read yesterday. Then each time when you are recalling, you will realize that there are some points you forgot, right? So go back to your textbook or your notes and then highlight what you forgot. So that's your weak area. That is what you have to identify, right? At the end of the week, also leave a certain amount of time for revision, right? For recalling. So you have to recall at the end of each topic, at the end of each day, and eventually at the end of the week. Now, during this process, each time you will recognize your weak area each time, because you will tend to forget each time, right? So each time you have highlighted your weaker areas, and those are the areas which you need to revise again, right? So importantly, you have to keep doing this processes again and again over the period that you are reading the entire subject, and finally you will realize that you each time you are revising lesser and lesser of content, and each time you are forgetting lesser and lesser of content, right? So it has to be a process. Learning has to be a process, and eventually when you sit down and revise the topic or the subject again after a month, you should be having in your hand this entire notepad or this entire note structure that you have created, these entire notes which are complete and concise, have been reread and revised, right? So please make sure that you are doing this repeatedly and recalling. And during this process, please remember that revision should not be merely rereading, right? Now, during the process of revision, please remember that you take regular tests. The method I just described of recalling with book closed is just another way of giving yourself a small test, right? Apart from that, you should be, sitting for regular tests, solving questions, and make it a habit of doing so, because the pattern of the exam is such that it is objective, and it's a problem-solving approach to the examination pattern that we have. And in the future, we are looking at the next examination, which is expected to be more clinically oriented. We saw a gist of that in the most recent AIMS examination as well, where clinical based questions were asked a lot, where you had to again reach out to your chunks, reach out to your differential diagnosis, and then answer the question. So this will come with practice. If you're not practicing questions, it will not happen right on the day of the examination, right? And solve questions, like I just said again earlier, and discuss and ask questions. Very, very importantly, at the end of each day or at the end of a week, whenever you have time, please make it a point that yes, we do meet friends, right? That's something that we all do. So discuss with your friends, ask questions, and do not refrain from asking questions with the faculty. And please do not think that somebody is going to judge you, or they are going to feel that you don't even know this. And I mean, this is a very bad thought process to have. This is a very bad mindset to have, right? Your mindset should be that I have to do better. If I don't know, fine, I'll ask, I'll get my answer, and then I will do better. You don't have to worry about how other people are judging you, because Your judgment will come on the day of your exam, not while you are preparing for it, right? So please remember that as well. And friends, eventually, at the end, I would like to say that some of us have this habit of, you know, leaving questions till the end, or while doing questions, the solution book is also, answer booklet is also opened right in front of us. Right, so we're not spending too much time on a question, right? The what we are doing is we read a question, and if I know the answer, fine. If I don't know the answer, I'm not bothering to even think about it. I'm quickly going through the solution and reading it and marking it. That's wrong. You have to solve questions. You can't be just going through solutions, right? Look at this analogy. Let me tell you. Like, for example, if you have to go from home to your college, right? And you go every day, you go via cab. One day you have to go on your own and you forgot your way. It's very difficult that you will be able to find your way if you don't have Google Maps, right? That's because each day somebody else was driving you. But if you yourself are driving from home to college every day, then even if you lose your way, you can figure out the way, right? Or even if you forget the way, make a wrong turn, you can come back because you've been driving yourself, you've been practicing yourself. And that's how you have to do it in exams as well, in preparing as well. You know, you can't be just looking through solutions. You need to rack your brains. If you've not worked through the concept, if you're not working through the question, there is no point just merely reading the solution to it. So spend time on a question for which you don't know the answer. Also, spend time on it, think about it, maybe even come to the wrong answer. No problem, mark a wrong answer and then go to the solution and see, okay, my answer is wrong. Why is it wrong? Right? And this will help you correct your errors, and this will help you build your concepts and help you retain longer. Okay? So please, very, very important, take regular tests and start simply by changing your mindset about certain things. That is all that is required to begin with. That is a change in your mindset, a firm belief that you can do it, right? And of course, you should be consistent and revising on a regular basis, right? And keeping in mind the important points I told you about the techniques of revising and revision. And at the end of it all, yes, eventually you can give yourself a weekly break, and then you can give yourself a monthly break. And those breaks are equally important as well. So that's it for now, friends, in this session. And for more such videos and content and lectures and one-on-one live interaction, you can subscribe to Unacademy. You can use my code SHONALI and get a 10% discount on all of your subscriptions, right? So thank you and goodbye.